Headline Audio presents Invader, Sacrifice, the fifth in the Invader Novella series by Simon Scarrow and TJ Andrews. Read for you by Jonathan Keeble.
Chapter 1. A throated roar went up from the crowd as the rebel prisoner stepped into the makeshift arena. He looked round nervously at the heaving throng of off-duty Roman soldiers, traders and Britons gathered on the earth embankments.
"Oh, this will be over quickly, sir," Vatia said. "That skinny one doesn't stand a hope in Hades. Not against that big bloody bastard."
Figulus glanced at his comrade, then looked on as a pair of orderlies dragged away the lifeless corpse of the previous fighter. Blood disgorged from a deep wound across the slain Briton's chest, leaving a glistening wet trail on the damp grass. The gaunt prisoner briefly stopped in his tracks as he caught sight of the dead fighter, before one of the legionaries, on arena duty, shoved him forward. Several paces away stood his opponent, a towering Durotrigan, his bare torso covered in swirling tattoos and rippling with taut muscle. He gripped a short sword in his right hand and glared at the next challenger. The swordsman had already seen off three opponents in a series of brutal fights to the death, with the winner staying on. Now the crowd hushed in anticipation of the last bout of the day's games. The grim public spectacle had been arranged by Trinegassus. As soon as the king had begun to recover from his injuries and was well enough to leave the infirmary, a team of engineers had begun hastily erecting the earth and timber arena in a low vale situated between the fort and Lindinus. The games were intended to provide some much-needed entertainment for the Roman garrison, as well as the king's beleaguered subjects. They would also serve as a warning of the punishment awaiting all those who would dare to defy the Durotrigan king. While they awaited further orders, Figulus and the surviving rankers in his detachment had decided to take in the action. Since noon, the crowd had looked on as 40 pairs of rebels had taken to the arena with a variety of weapons, in a crude imitation of the gladiator contests held back in Rome. Some fought with long Celtic swords, others wielded tridents or broad axes, and one bout even featured two Britons fighting bare-knuckled. A few of the prisoners had turned their weapons on themselves, preferring death over fighting their fellow rebels. But most had fought willingly enough, since Trinegassus had declared that the champion would be spared death and instead be sold into slavery.
"What do you reckon, sir?" Vatia asked. "Who's your money on?"
Figulus rubbed his bristly jaw as he assessed the fighters. The swordsman was several inches taller and considerably bulkier than his opponent. But the effort of the previous fights had taken its toll on the huge Durotrigan, and he looked tired, Figulus thought. His chest muscles were heaving up and down as he caught his breath.
"I reckon the challenger's got a chance." "That lanky streak of piss," Vatia spluttered. "I'm sorry, sir, but there's more chance of finding an honest man in the Senate than the skinny one winning."
Figulus glanced at Vatia and smiled. The short, squat legionary had been born in the slums of the Aventine district in Rome, and the cocky young rogue was never short of an opinion.
"Well, fancy yourself as an expert, do you, lad?" Figulus grinned. "Well, if there's one thing I know, sir, it's gladiator fights. I used to be a ticket tout at the Statilius Taurus Amphitheatre. I've seen all the great fighters down the years."
Vatia counted them off on his podgy fingers.
"Britomaris, Tetrates, even Pavo. And I reckon the swordsman's going to win this one by a mile." "As long as it's a good fight, I couldn't give a shoe wins,"
muttered Pulcher, another of the surviving legionaries.
"Half of these scraps have been bloody useless. I've seen Greek schoolchildren fight better than this."
Figulus turned back to the arena as the umpire for the occasion, a centurion Minucius from the 8th cohort, introduced the two fighters. A hushed silence descended over the arena as one of the legionaries stepped forward and thrust a spear into the challenger's right hand. The prisoner looked down at his weapon, wielding it awkwardly as he tested its weight. Opposite him, the swordsman flexed his muscles, the point of his blood-stained short sword glinting under the pallid winter light.
"Fight's about to begin, sir," Vatia said, rubbing his hands gleefully.
Figulus smiled uncertainly. Normally, he would have been excited about the contest. He enjoyed a good gladiator bout as much as the next man, but for the past few days he'd been racked with guilt over Helva and Rullus. In his darker moments, Figulus tormented himself with images of his comrades in the enemy camp, grimly awaiting their fate. Or perhaps they were already dead, he thought, their heads parted from their shoulders, or burned alive in one of the druid's terrifying wicker effigies. A sharp crack split the air as the umpire lashed his whip. The crowd erupted into a deafening roar as the fight began. "Here we go!" Poulcher said, punching a fist in the air. The swordsman wasted no time in charging at his opponent, eager to make a quick kill and claim his prize as champion of the games. The spearman quickly stepped back out of range as the larger Briton thrust at him and almost lost his footing on the blood-slicked ground. He caught himself and staggered backwards as the swordsman lunged, the latter narrowly missing with a quick thrust at the vitals. The Romans and traders in the crowd roared their encouragement. The Britons were more subdued, uneasy about witnessing the public killing of their fellow Durotrigans, and many of them looked on sullenly as the two rebels fought to the death. Figulus glanced away from the contest and lowered his gaze to Trenegasus. The Durotrigan king sat close to the action, flanked by his sizable entourage and the two sections of battle-hardened legionaries who'd been assigned to his temporary bodyguard. Trenegasus still looked weak, Figulus thought. His skin was pale as chalk, and a large dressing covered the wound the king had taken on his scalp. Despite his injuries, Trenegasus sat rigidly upright, a smile trembling on his lips as he watched the contest unfold below. Figulus looked back to the action as the muscular Briton caught his breath, then charged at his opponent. The challenger's face was a picture of concentration as he sidestepped the blow and, in a lightning blur, spun around to the side of his dumbfounded opponent before drawing his weapon across the back of the swordsman's legs. The crowd let out a collective gasp as the spear tip slashed open the Briton's calf, spilling blood across the ground in a red spray. Then the spearman jabbed the butt of his weapon into the man's back, and the swordsman crashed to the ground. In a flash, the spearman moved towards his opponent and kicked the sword out of the man's reach. Then he hefted up his weapon in a two-handed grip as he prepared to plunge it down at the swordsman's throat. Pockets of the crowd rose to their feet, desperate to catch the moment of the kill.
"Oh, get up, you idiot!"
Vatia urged. The challenger brought his weapon down towards his stricken opponent, but the swordsman quickly rolled to his right, narrowly avoiding the spear as it thudded into the ground. He scrambled to his feet as the challenger twisted at the waist and thrust at the larger Briton. This time the swordsman evaded the blow and then clasped a huge hand around the spear shaft, pulling it towards him and forcing the challenger to lean forward. At the same time, the swordsman brought up his right knee and slammed it into the challenger's face. There was a sharp crack as the smaller Briton's nose shattered. He staggered backwards, groaning nasally as he released his grip on his weapon.
"Finish him!"
Vatia implored at the top of his voice. Grabbing the spear with both hands and swiftly reversing it, the swordsman lunged at his disorientated opponent. The challenger saw the danger too late. He howled in agony as the spear punched into his stomach. Then the swordsman gave the spear a twist, skewering the other man's vitals and drawing a huge cheer from the crowd. Blood spewed out of the wound as the swordsman ripped his weapon free. The challenger wavered on the spot for a moment before collapsing. Cheers rang out around the arena as the swordsman tossed aside his weapon, pumping his fists in the air in a defiant posture of victory.
"The swordsman wins!"
Vatia turned to Figulus, grinning.
"What did I tell you, sir?"
Figulus said nothing. In the corner of his eye, he spied Trenegasus signalling to the umpire. The latter barked an order at the legionaries forming a circle around the edge of the arena, and the three soldiers nearest to the action promptly stepped forward and approached the victorious Briton. Two of the legionaries grabbed the man by his arms. The Briton glanced around in alarm. At the same time, the third legionary drew his sword, and the rebel immediately understood what was happening. He tried to wrestle free from the two soldiers, but they had a solid grip, and they forced the Briton to his knees.
"What's going on, sir?"
Vatia asked.
"I thought the old fool had promised to spare the winner."
"It looks like Trenegasus has changed his mind,"
Figulus replied, frowning. A surge of nausea rose in the back of the Optio's throat as the soldiers prepared to carry out the execution. All around the arena, the natives were muttering angrily at this unexpected denouement to the games, while the soldiers and traders roared for the Juratrigan rebel to be put to death. The spectators looked towards the king as he rose unsteadily to his feet. Trenegasus paused as he regarded the rebel with a look of cold indifference. Then he turned to address his subjects.
"My people, hear me,"
the king declared, struggling to make his frail voice heard.
"There can be no mercy shown to our enemies. None. Those who would dare to defy me, who would dare to betray their king and the tribe that gave them life, have forfeited their right to draw breath. They must die like the traitorous dogs they are."
His voice trembled with rage, and Figulus could see his bony hands shaking at his sides as he glanced defiantly around the arena before continuing.
"This I command, as your rightful king and ruler."
Trenegasus gestured to the umpire before he slumped back down onto his seat. Minucius shouted an order to his men, and the legionary who'd drawn his weapon traced the point of his sword across the Briton's stomach.
"They're gonna gut the bastard,"
Pulcher muttered. The Briton tensed his muscles. He lifted his gaze to the crowd and stared defiantly at his fellow tribesmen as he shouted to them.
"What's he saying, sir?"
Vatia asked.
"He says he does not fear death,"
Figulus translated queasily.
"He says the Dark Moon Druids will rise once again and cleanse the kingdom of the Roman invaders. All those who have betrayed the tribe's gods will suffer. Calamus, their high priest, and the loyal servant of Kruak has foretold it."
He listened for a moment, then went on.
"Soon the land will run red with Roman blood, and the legions will be driven back into the sea."
The Briton finished talking and clamped his eyes tightly shut. His muscles visibly convulsed as the legionary drew his sword arm back. Then the legionary slashed his blade across the Briton's stomach in a single clean blow, ripping open the man's guts. The Briton let out a hideous garbled scream as his bowels slopped out of the wound and slid down his front, spilling to the ground between his feet in a glistening red and grey heap. Some of the natives seated closer to the arena looked away in horror. Figulus forced himself to watch as the two legionaries, holding the Briton by his arms, released their grip and let the man flop to the ground. Then the third legionary thrust down with his bloodied sword, sinking the tip behind the man's neck just above the collarbone. The Briton jerked briefly as the sword cut through his spine. Then he went limp. A tense silence descended over the arena. As soon as the execution had been carried out, the king gestured to the Roman officer in charge of his personal bodyguard. Centurion Minucius turned to his men and barked at them.
"Boy, lads! Fucking move yourselves! Clear a path through this fucking rabble!"
The legionaries snapped to attention and began escorting the king out of the arena, shoving aside the crowd with their shields and drawing several curses and angry glares from the sullen natives. Centurion Minucius marched a step ahead of Trenegasus, his sword arm gripping his sheathed weapon, ready to lash out at anyone who tried to step too close to the king. After Trenegasus had departed, the rest of the crowd slowly began to stream out of the temporary arena, trudging back towards the settlement to the south and grumbling discontentedly amongst themselves. As the last of the spectators quit the arena, the orderlies began clearing up. Teams collected up the weapons that had been used for the games and loaded them onto the cart to return to the fort stores, while others dragged away the dead rebels to be dumped in the local midden for the wild animals to feast on.
"Well, about a drink, then?"
Vatia suggested, glancing around at the faces of his comrades.
"I've worked up a decent thirst after that, sir."
Before he could reply, Figulus noticed a clerk hurrying over from the direction of the fort. The clerk glanced around the arena, quickly searching the faces in the crowd shuffling out of the various exits. He caught sight of Figulus and marched briskly over.
"Optio, there you are,"
said the clerk as he caught his breath.
"I've been looking all over for you."
"What do you want?"
Figulus demanded. The clerk stiffened.
"A message from the Tribune. He wants to see you at headquarters."
Figulus frowned heavily.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.